Well, first of all, thank you so much for being here. I'm so excited, and I hope you're excited as well. We're going back to the moon. And I mean, I wish I was a child again. I wish I could start all over, but hey. So, where is my clicker? I was hoping that there would be more students here, more of science and engineering students, because the fact that we are, which way? The fact that that we are going back and that we have the technologies to do it, there are still a number of problems that need to be tackled, and this requires ingenuity, a lot of knowledge, discipline. We need all science and engineering educated individuals to help us go the next step. So, you know, let us just start with a simple question. How do we expand our human presence out there? Well, you know, when I started my career, when I went to school to get an education, the conversation was, we're going to Mars. And I was just so excited. And in fact, my doctoral work was precisely on a proposal I submitted to NASA as to how we can develop not a chemical rocket, but a different kind, so that we can get there faster. Because after the lunar landing, the conversation was like, well, now we're gonna go to Mars. Okay. Well, here we are. And yes, I hope that in my lifetime, we can take the next gigantic leap and have humans finally land on Mars. But, you know, if you ask me for an opinion, I will tell you we're not quite ready to get there. Our technology, yes, it is mature, and but probably would take a very long time to get us to Mars. And so I agree with NASA that we're gonna first return to the moon and get all these difficulties that need to be resolved, and most importantly, that we learn how to live permanently, not just go and return in a few hours, but actually really, really understand and learn to be out there. So NASA announced just a few weeks ago the Artemis NASA Lunar Exploration Program. This is a very bold idea that will intend to send the first woman to the moon. And of course, the next man, for me, you know. Whomever wants to go should be able to go, okay? And so I don't want to talk too much about the first woman landing. I don't want 50 years from now another person giving a talk and saying, so-and-so gave the first step on the moon. I hope many people. But anyway, like I said, you know, there's this beautiful plan that I wanted to share a little bit about. It's just highlights. I cannot, you know, spend all my time, although I could spend hours and hours and hours telling you about it. But one of the things that it is different from the previous lunar program is that now we're going to go there, but we're going to build a station, an orbiting spacecraft that would be habitable, that there would be a number of people doing research, observing the moon, and some of them traveling to the moon, which means we still need a lot of technologies to develop, you know, such as how we're gonna do that. You know, the station is still not ready, although we know a lot about the space station here orbiting the Earth. We still don't know much about how we're gonna have one that is going to be permanently going around the moon. So that station has already a name. It's Getaway. And Getaway for a reason, okay? So let's proceed. Let me move. You know, I was hoping that, all the seats would be full, but since they're not, so I'm gonna come around. And my technical support will help me if I kind of run out of equipment here. Okay, so for those plans, the NASA it is now promoting requires huge rocket trucks, you know, in order to take the vehicle and its payload, whatever payload that is, and I'm talking about spacecraft full of people, from zero to orbital velocity. And so right now, you know, the focus has been on developing that capability. The rockets that will take us from the ground to that position in space from where we're gonna to the moon. Okay, so I really was hoping that there would be more students here so I could ask questions about rocket science, but so anyway, you know, most of us are familiar at least with how the rockets look. Okay, and so if I show you, this is a comparison of space launch systems, and so the new system is on the right hand side, and just as you can see here, please go. It resembles a little bit of that space launch vehicle that took the first people to the moon. But there's a difference, and my intention is to just give you some highlights of that. And of course, again, you know, we require all this power. The new launch system, we call it the space launch system. It doesn't have a name like, you know, the space shuttle that everybody recognizes. For now, you know, we call it the SLS. It is intended to provide 13% much thrust at launch as compared with the space shuttle that we all know. And 15% more than the Saturn V during liftoff and ascent to orbit. So that's the plan, that's the intention, okay? And of course, you know, we call it the heavy lifter because it's capable, or will be capable, of carrying more payload to the moon than the shuttle could do just to go to the space station. So here's, you know, our destinations. We want to go, again, you know, mainly to the moon, but we also want to go to Mars. And like I said, I still hope that in my lifetime, you know, we achieve, you know, some human mission to Mars, even if it's just going around. And of course, you know, in order to do that, the capability of our rockets have to be able to escape the gravitational field of our beautiful Earth. So for that, again, we need a powerful machine. You know, we need powerful rockets. And I'm not going to tell you everything. You don't have to read all that. I just wanted you to be aware that there is a plan in which NASA intends to take the first version of that launch vehicle and expand its capability as we progress, as we achieve the milestones that we say we're going to achieve. You know, with first, let's get to the moon. And as we progress, we make this, you know, more and more powerful. So I'm just going to talk about the first step. You know, the Artemis 1. You know, this is the first mission in which the entire system is going to deliver a crew spacecraft, even though it's going to go empty. It's not going to have astronauts in it. But it is intended to ensure that everything works fine, that we're not going to put any people in danger, that the capability, it is as we say it is. So the first version that you see on the right-hand side, that is what we call the Block 1 crew configuration. So the first flight, hopefully 5 years from now, we'll come together. Everybody who's here, promise me to come back, and we see if indeed NASA made the promise reality, because I'm gonna hold them to it, okay? So Artemis 1 is going, what we call the exploration mission 1. First crew lunar flight exploration mission 2 would be when now we know that it is sure that we can do it. And so now four chosen individuals are going to travel to the moon. Okay, so let's talk about it. Like I said, the vehicle looks similar to the one that took the first man to the moon. But there are some differences. You know, one of the, if you're a rocket scientist, I mean, you will be very excited about this, okay? So the core, you know, like the spine of this SLS launch system is what we call the core stage. This core stage is depicted in this figure, in which you can see, you know, it's mainly propellant, in other words, fuel and oxidizer that are going to fuel the main engines. At the bottom of this core stage, you see the engine section. It has four main engines. They are rocket engines that use hydrogen and oxygen. Well, those are heritage from the space shuttle. Those are beautiful engines, oh, powerful as they can be. And but guess what? When they terminated the space shuttle program, NASA ended up with a bunch of engines there that are amazing. You know, when I was a graduate student, I worked on calculating, you know, the thermal loads on that engine. So I know the capability that it has. And as you can see here, the hydrogen tank will hold 537,000 gallons of liquid hydrogen. And there is an interstation between, and then there is the liquid oxygen tank. And as you can read, you know, how much of propellant is in it. So it is an amazing thing. All that tank, the core itself, is taller than the space shuttle. So I hope that you can imagine that. And all that propellant is needed to power those rocket engines to produce about 2 million pounds of thrust. This is what we need. And of course, we also need the rocket booster, solid rocket boosters, in order to get us out of the gravitational field of our Earth. So again, you know, my rocket scientist, I love rockets. I can tell you we're gonna need rockets of all kinds. We're gonna need rockets to take us up to some low orbit. And then we need rockets to take us away from that altitude and put us in the trajectory to take us to the moon. And so I just put here, you know, just some pictorials of that propulsion capability that we need. And of course, we also need propulsion. We also need little rockets to help us navigate once we leave the neighborhood of our Earth. I just wanted to, you know, I wanted to share this with students, you know, just to get a sense if you've never seen a rocket engine. The main engines, remember, we're going to have four in the core stage. Those engines are humongous. They are the size of a small compact car. And you can imagine how much they weigh. Okay? I put here a picture of all the workers that are trying to steer. They're transporting one of those engines to the center where it's going to be tested. On the right-hand side, you have another also engine that has been used over and over, but a number of launch systems. You know, this is the last stage, the one that is attached to the payload, whether it is a crew vehicle or something else that we're shooting away. And so that is the size of that. So for the very first flight, we're going to use only one of those, the RL-10 rocket. And again, like I said, that is the one that gives the final push to the spacecraft. You know, once it's in orbit, and then you want it to put it in the direction of the moon, or what we call the injection velocity. The SLS is going to have something that the previous system didn't have. It's going to have the capability of aborting and saving the crew if something were to happen during the launch and ascent to orbit. And in fact, when I was, one of the jobs I had at one of the rocket companies that were working at that time, this is about 10 years ago, and developing the solid rocket motors that were attached to, I didn't work on it. I'm not a solid rocket booster, but it was for those little rockets that go there. And this system has been tested on the ground. And just last week, I believe, there was a launch system in which it tested its capability of really saving the crew spacecraft in case that will be needed in the future, but hopefully it will not. And this is how astronauts are going to travel. This is a beautiful, 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 beautiful chrome module, we call it, or ion. Again, if you've seen all the media about how the three astronauts went to the moon, you might think that it looks similar, and it is in the sense that it's a capsule type spacecraft. However, there are some differences. You know, this is going to carry four people rather than three. And also the advances in the technology to protect, and to keep those four individuals in space is enormous. Before, the astronauts were going for just a few days, and now the intention is to go, for longer periods of time. So this is the Orion, and at the end of this talk, I'm going to have my little model of the Orion, which is a replica. The true replica with even the little rockets that it has. And if anybody wants to take a selfie with it at the end outside, you're welcome, and it even has the solar arrays and, so you can see little details of how this spacecraft looks like. And of course, you wonder, if there are four people going to the moon, they need food. They need facilities. They need way to survive the trip. Okay, so we have what we call the service module. So that's the primary power and propulsion component that is going to provide everything that those individuals are going to need. And so the European Space Agency is contributing to developing this module for the first Artemis mission. And so therefore, now we call it, the European Service Module, only because ESA is developing it. So, and it also is going to incorporate some rockets that we're very familiar with. So we know, that they are reliable and they have the capability, the performance to do the job that they is intended to do. Here again, this talk was intended for students. All the requirements that were set for engineers to develop the system. So don't pay too much attention to that. But there, this is it requires also a rocket engine. That engine has enough thrust to lift a van here on Earth. So that's powerful, even though small. The fuel tanks hold 2,000 liters of fuel. And according to ESA, don't quote me, I'm just quoting ESA, they said that would be enough to fill about 50 cars with gasoline. And there's a number of things are written there, but the most important thing is that it will have supplies for 20 days mission. So, but however, you know, those four individuals better not expect McDonald's or anything like that. No buffets there. So, you know, everything will be rationed. So don't expect a lot of food, you know, all those kind of things. Because everything has to fit in this system. And this is for those of you who know about the Apollo. And this is just a comparison, like I told you. You know, there are some similarities. But Orion is a little roomier because it's going to have four people rather than three. And also because it's going to be for longer missions, not just a few days. And so, you know, the size, of course, you know, is different. And the shape is also slightly different because now, you know, during reentry, this has to survive the trip. Okay. Again, let me summarize this because right now, you know, the media is just going about talking about Artemis, and you say, why Artemis? Anybody knows why they called the first, yes?
It's called Artemis because Artemis is the Greek god of the moon.
And because she's the twin sister
of Apollo,
right? Oh,
cool.
and because he's a woman, and because Artemis is supposed to take the first woman. I would say women. Maybe it's for women. I hope. Anyway, so again, this is NASA's program to return astronauts to the moon and of course prepare humanity to expand. And they chose now to land on the South Pole of the moon. Okay? Okay, why the South Pole? Anybody? Why? Yes? No? Yes, please?
More sunlight?
Yes, that's one thing. And the other?
Water.
Water. You know, all the robotic missions today confirm there's water on the poles, and especially the South Pole, as you said, you know, we can have sunlight. So we can go and first of all, come out with some form of solar power to produce energy. And if indeed we can do something with this frozen water that is there, wonderful, right? So that's the reason. That's the reason why we're choosing to go back to the moon, but at the South Pole. So, Chinese already sent a lander, a robotic lander, to the South. Actually, they sent already their vehicles for several years, but just in January, they sent this lander to the South Pole. I still don't know what they're finding. They're not sharing with me any of their findings, okay? But anyway, I'm on the side, and so I saw that outside in the activities for children, there was a game about finding where humans have landed already on the moon. So, well, they already took that spotlight, but that's all right. So how many times have humans landed on the moon? How many times?
Well,
less than that. But that's all right. We landed enough. Yes. And but we have also landed robots, and we learned so much that if you think about what was taught in astronomy courses 50 years ago, probably is nothing of what we've learned in the past 50 years. Okay, so anyway, I also put here the all the spots of where not only the U.S. but Russia and China have landed, and I'm also adding India because India is ready to send their first lander. They were supposed to do it on Monday, but something went wrong, and so now they told me, I don't know if it's true, that that the launch is scheduled for next week on Monday, and of course, you know, they don't have people, but that's fine. You know, they're gonna go and explore, and I also made the distinction. These are soft landings, meaning we didn't crash because we've also done a lot of impact missions, right? So these were in which we have demonstrated technology that we can land and really achieve something there. So, okay, question. How far is the moon? Well, you see, typically in the classroom, and even at the university level, when we talk about the moon, we represent the Earth here and the moon right here. Well, it's actually pretty far. And in my little schematic here, I try to use, you know, a representation of the actual, you know, separation. There is a huge distance between the Earth and the moon. So this is hopefully, and of course, you know, first we need to know where it is. We need to know everything about the moon, how it moves, how it, you know, what is the relationship with the Earth, with the relationship with the sun, and so forth and so forth. But that's a class for astronomy. But most importantly for me is how do we get there? And of course, not only how do we get there, but how long is the journey? Those of you who know about the Apollo program, remember how many days it took for the astronauts to get there? More or less, right? And so it's a long distance. So let's move on because I know that I can speak all day, but let me close this. So anyway, for me, the most important thing is how we get there. Another thing, you know, we talk also about cislunar space, that's the spherical volume that is centered on the Earth, with a radius that is equal to the average distance between the Earth and the Moon, okay? So that's where we're gonna be operating now, instead of just operating at where the space station is. And here again, this is, you know, the research that I do about, you know, how to get there efficiently. We're not going by the way the Apollo astronauts went. They went on a shoot like this. We're going a different way. We learn a lot about space in our neighborhood. So now we're going to use a completely different way of orbiting the moon. We're gonna go farther than the Apollo astronauts ever went. And again, you know, if you take my course, I'll teach you everything about it. So I'm gonna go fast because I know I'm running out of time. But this is, you know, this is just a little bit of how, you know, this is a lot of mathematics, a lot of science going into defining the trajectory that Artemis astronauts are going to follow. So let me move on. Here is some real people testing, you know, the Orion. And I put them there in the launch configuration, just like the Apollo astronauts. They're gonna be launched, laying down like you are, sitting like that, reclining, because, you know, that's the spacecraft. So here, the configuration of those four individuals going in. Obviously, you know, as they leave the low orbit, you know, now you can move the capsule in a more convenient way. So here I put traveling, you know, I put the astronauts now sitting face, although in space there's no up and down, east, west, so forth. Okay. So here's again representation of how the astronauts are going. You're late, you're late, you're late. You're not going to answer my questions. Sorry. So imagine now we're on this spacecraft. So I'm sure one of you is going to say, are we there yet? Right? Well, an engineer, a scientist knows how to answer that question. We can calculate the flight time to the moon. The flight time depends on where we took off, where near orbit, and at what speed we left. So, you know, I'm not going to go through the entire derivation here, but just look on the right-hand side. This is a curve that represents the flight time versus the injection velocity. This is, remember I told you there is a rocket that is going to inject our spacecraft after it reaches low orbit. Okay, so here, you know, I just choose, this is an example, for injection on altitude of 320 kilometers, the minimum injection velocity that you need to impose on your spacecraft is on the order of 10.82 kilometers per second. And I put there how much it was Apollo. Apollo, as you can see here, it was a little bit over that, obviously, confirming while we calculate, right? And so it was chosen. Remember, they never sent people to the moon to land on it. There were still many unknowns. But analytically, you could predict. And so the flight time for the Apollo landing mission was chosen to be about 72 hours, which is about a little bit over 3 days, right? Why that? Well, you know, not only the uncertainty, so we didn't know how to do it. If our analytics and analysis was going to work, but also, you know, because there were three individuals there, you needed to supply to them food, liquids, and so forth, right? So, but also if you look, if you're a scientist, an engineer, looking down at this graph, you say, look, if I can just increase a little bit my injection velocity, I can get there faster. So indeed, you know, we can move just a tiny bit. Let's put a rocket that is a little bit more efficient. And so we can reduce, instead of getting there in 3-4 days, we could do it in shorter time. And of course, you know, here's what we're aiming for. So again, it all depends on our rockets and how we calculate this. This is the Lunar Space Station. No, this is not it. This is just an artistic depiction of what we intend to have. And so, no, this will not be of the size of this International Space Station that is orbiting the Earth. This will be much smaller, because astronauts will not be there, you know, like 6 months, 8 months, as the way they do it here. But here, they're so close to us, right? But there, they're going to be far away. So it's not intended to for astronauts to remain there for a long time. Remember, we're still learning, you know, how to live in space. So let me skip this because I know that it will not make much sense at this point. But this is one depiction of how that small lunar space station might look like. And this is only depicting, you know, where the astronauts are going to live. I mean, I'm sorry, to work. It doesn't show the module where they will live. And in fact, it would be about the size of a little studio apartment, okay? So not much, no huge Texan-type houses, all right? Okay, so like I said, astronauts will visit Getaway at least once per year and can live and work on board for up to 3 months at a time. And they will conduct experiments, take trips to the moon if we have the capability to do that. You know, this is no science fiction. This is what we're planning to do. Okay, here is photographs of actual engineers doing, you know, all the testing and ensuring that everything is supposed to work the way it is. NASA sent out a call for proposals, and we have about five different companies that submitted, you know, their ideas as to how to build the habitation prototypes. And as you can see here, Sierra Nevada, one company that probably many of you haven't heard about, Independence One, Lockheed Martin, of course, Bigelow, and Northrop Grumman. So they all have their ideas, and we haven't chosen which one will be the one that is built. Now, I don't want to tell you that all this is a bed of roses. This space is very dangerous. The human body is not made for space. You know, we learn a lot by sending astronauts to the space station. And remember, they stay longer and longer and longer. But there are a number of very dramatic effects on the human body that are, you know, space medicine has improved enormously. And of course, you know, that has led for us here on Earth to benefit from those advancements. And so here, you know, there are effects on the bones, on the blood, on the muscles, the brain, heart, blood vessels, and you name it. If you're a doctor, if you're a nurse, you know how important those things are. But one of the only things I wanted to share with you right now is about radiation. It has been a lot of tremendous technological advances in order to learn how we protect humans when we expand our presence in deep space. So radiation is absolutely damaging. Cosmic rays are going to do a lot of damage to our bodies. You know, we have certain parts in our body that are very extremely sensitive to radiation. And I'm just going to share with you a new experiment that we call it the MAR experiment, that the U.S. and Israel are working very closely together. Of course, European space agency is also working on a similar approach. But in this one, this is going, they are developing a wearable, a protective, it's like a garment, like a vest. Okay, because women in particular, you know, they have even more risk of cancer, breast cancer, and so as you can see here by these two engineers wearing one of the prototypes, and so for the first mission, it's going to go with the crew spacecraft, but without people. Is going to have two models, one with the vest, one without it, with all the instrumentation in order to test its capacity to protect the human body from that cosmic radiation. So, I know that I'm running out of time, but you know, again, this was intended to, you know, to really have the students, you know, get all excited about this, but I want to give them quizzes. Sorry. So what is the temperature on the moon? Well, trust me, this is not something that you will go without a coat. And you will not go unprotected. It's not only the radiation, but the temperature ranges from boiling hot to freezing cold. Okay? So all that is important for us because we need to know how we're going to manage when we get there. So anyway, then we're coming back. Returning home is not as nice as it is when we take a trip and come back home. It's not gonna be a joyful occasion. It's gonna be full of danger. And so technologies to develop that capability to bring people safely from a mission to the moon is extremely important. And so, what we call atmospheric entering and landing is, again, there are groups of engineers devoted to developing all the technologies that are needed in order to return safely. And there are, NASA has been conducting lots of testing. As you can see here, on the right-hand side, these are actual individuals that testing how we land, because when they return from the moon, remember, The mission is designed to live from Florida. So we're going to shoot this astronauts to the moon from Florida, but when they return, the trajectory is such that they're going to land on the west side of the U.S. And they're going to land on the water. So I just wanted to mention here, you know, the India mission, which I think is very exciting. You know, they're going to do it differently. Because, you know, they're not intending to send people, so it's going to take them a couple of months to get to the moon. Okay, so their trajectory is completely different, so it, you might want to hear about that. So, I know I can talk another day, but let me collect my breath and ask you, you know, today when we are here commemorating the first humans to land in another celestial object, when we commemorate the first landing. And of course, I want to also mention that typically we all think of the astronauts as heroes because they are. You know, they are willing to give their lives. They are willing, and in fact, this plaque that you see at the bottom, this was left in one of those Apollo missions, there on the moon, with the names of all the people that lost their life trying to get there. And of course, I also want to honor every single person with science, engineering, mathematics, technology, a background who contribute to making that amazing achievement for humanity. You know, you hardly hear about the engineers who build all those things. NASA has estimated that there were on the order of 100,000 people, engineers, who build this thing. Okay? So now, you know, I'm hoping that there's somebody here in this room who will help or will take the next giant leap for humanity. I hope I'm alive and that we can get together again and celebrate the next human person who gets to the moon, because this is probably one of what makes us united into just one planet. Okay? This would be an achievement for us, for all of us. And in fact, I need to tell you that now the plans, there's no Cold War. Now we're trying to reach out. This requires collaboration from all nations. And that's my saying. And I just want to publicly acknowledge NASA. NASA has given me a lot. My education is thanks to NASA. I'm a NASA fellow. I'm very proud of it. And now I'm a NASA ambassador, which is even amazing. And so here's a little gift from NASA, this vehicle.
American astronauts to the moon, not only to leave behind footprints and flags, but to build the foundation we need to send Americans to Mars and beyond.
Thank you.
That's how we get home. Yeah.